Good evening. I'm gonna talk about amber fakes, or what we think are amber fake beads. The presentation says two unusual cases, but actually last week we found a third one. So we're gonna talk about three cases of coated beads that resembles amber. So amber has a quality. It's translucent. It's reddish yellow. And it's highly demand for personal ornamentation, for making beads, pendants, charms, every kind, many kinds of personal adornments. Now, there are also some imitations made of other local or not so local stones that might resemble amber, as these citrine quartz beads. Many other also micas that are also yellow or reddish yellow, translucent. They are using in third millennium BC in the Iberian Peninsula. They are using several materials that might be considered perhaps imitations or amber fakes. What we have found here are unusual cases that they are using a resin. We'll see it. We'll see it on the next slide, for coating local, mainly shells and seeds, to produce beads that resembles amber. This technique has been not for resembling amber, but in Near East they are using a procedure to transform bone and produce a blue coating that resembles or imitate turquoise. So it's more or less the same thing. It's getting some raw material locally available and performing some technical procedures that makes those non-valuable materials more valuable because they resemble something that is really valuable. So we have here the first two cases that we have already documented. As you can see there, we have a core, that's the bead, and a coating. If you see this one, it's exactly this visually identical to some amber beads that appear together with this one. So we got actually amber beads mixed up with these fake amber beads. So you see here, these are the new case, that's from Sao Paulo, and they really resemble what is amber. You see, these are ambers from Bragança in Portugal. As you can see, these ones really resembles that one. So we present here three sites, Cova del Gegant, La Molina and Sao Paulo too. I'm gonna go on through the archaeological context very quickly. So Cova del Gegant, it's a 1600-1400 BC site, it's a Bronze Age site, where they appear gold tutuli objects, several beads. Two of them have been already studied and published and has been documented as Sicilian amber. So we have an association of this technique here with Sicilian amber. We got La Molina. It's a early third millennium BC artificial cave. It has two faces. In the area where they found the beads, there are three adults. They are ivory objects. They are cinnabar. Rock crystal arrowheads. So we've got somehow wealthy burials, both of them. The Bronze Age one of Cova del Gegant, where we have gold tutuli. This one with cinnabar, rock crystal ivory, and Sao Paulo II in Almada. It's also an artificial cave. It has a minimum number of individuals of 254. And we found, well, typical grave goods for this period. It's 4th, 3rd millennial BC. We got as well two amber beads, two Sicilian amber beads together. In this case, what you've seen before as being, it's two beads, two fake beads for La Molina. We don't have amber there. Four fake beads for Cova del Gegant and two amber beads. And in this case, we've got two Sicilian amber beads and 316 fake beads. That it's this this necklace. So we are working on this material. We have documented more coated resins. There's one more site, Bronze Age site, but we're not sure if that it is pine resin. It must be another kind of resin. So we are not presenting it here. So from an unusual case, we are finding that this is more usual than we thought. For characterizing the material, this coating, we've been using an electron microscope, basically the microprof for chemical composition, a handheld EDX analyzer as well for chemical composition, infrared spectroscopy with microscope and on the pellet on transmission mode, XRD diffraction, a non-destructive one with the parallel beam and the and the mirrors, the Gebel mirrors, and Raman spectroscopy. This kind is a micro Raman, confocal micro Raman. So the first thing we made was the chemical composition. So we found that we've got in the core of the bead, it's the bead, you can see here, it's a chill, it's clearly a chill. And as well, on the rest of this coating, we found that it's calcium. Basically, it's calcite from the cave. And we found as well phosphorus. So, as you may know, phosphorus and calcium are the main components of bones. So, what we see on this superficial analysis, as they are non-destructive, we are always analyzing the surface of the bead and the and this coating. It's most likely bone, dissolved bone, that has recrystallized over the resin together with post-depositional calcite. When we make a micro FTIR, we see here that we have an, a specific band for the aragonite, it's this one at 1087, that corresponds to the core. And we have as well the calcite and the PO bonding vibrations corresponding to the bone. So what we have here is we have a core bead made of a marine mollusk, and the post-depositional process that has fixed over the resin calcite and calcium phosphate. So you can see here, if this is a calcite, you can see here the apatite, you can see here the resin. And here has the layering of this bead is. So you see like three phases. We'll go on it later. This is an oxidized phase of the resin. This is the resin, oxidized phase, and a superficial deposition of the calcite together with the recrystallization of bones from the burial. So, what we see with the micro XRF is what I've said, a superficial layer made by recrystallization of the hard tissue of human bones, plus a precipitation of calcite from the cave and the aragonite of the core. So you can see here, well, these are nice microscope photographs of the coatings. That it's really, you've seen on the microscope an amber bead, it's just like this. It's really very, very similar. So we didn't see the resin with the micro XRF. We didn't see it neither with the XRD or the Raman. So we decided to make a pellet and make a FTIR on the transmission mode. on reading, making a search of a bibliographic search, we've realized that it would be made perhaps be possible to differentiate between different species of producing these natural resins by FTIR. So we proceed, make FTIR. Well, now I'm gonna talk a little bit about the resins because this is needed to understand the FTIR spectra that we are gonna discuss later. So the resins may be of two kinds of insects or exudates for certain types of tree. So they are composed, they harden by evaporation of the volatiles and the partial oxidative polymerization of some of their components. This meaning that these are the terpenoids that corresponds to coniferae, leguminosae, and the pinus species. Each of these species produce resins, exudates resins, with different mixtures of components. Then when they age, results on different secondary compounds due to the oxidation, reduction, microbial activity. So with time, abietans, that are the main components of pine resins, transforms to abietic acid, dehydroabietic acid, also the hydroabietic acid, and 15-hydroxy-7-oxo dehydroabietic acid. So we found that resins are complex mixtures of molecules that change in time with aging, and that we can identify all these components and the subproducts of the age, of the aging of these molecules. So what we got, it's on the fingerprint region, it's on a spectra like this, where there are no really well-defined bands, but bands are much better than the ones we appreciate on the micro FTIR, that it's polluted with the phosphate due to the recrystallization of human heart tissue. That's this band here, this big band. We found the abietine carbon-carbon skeletal vibrations, but it's overlapped here as well. The abietic acid, the hydroabietic acid, all the molecules that we've been known by literature that has, there are subproducts of aging of these deterpenes. So the problem is, how do we find these equivalent resins aged by 5,000 years? So the best thing we have is a match with 14th century aged pinus resins. So there's been people from here, from Barcelona, studying the resins that has been applied to paintings from 14th century and have made a study of how these resins have aged with time. We find a fairly good match with pinus alepensis resins, aged resins. So, well, we have to make the second derivative, gap derivative, to find the position of the bands. You see here a lot of bands and numbers, and you may not see they're clearly defined. You make the second derivative, and you make you build a function to determine where the maximums and the minimums are. You can accurately identify the position of the bands and compare them with the, I'm finishing, with the references. So all these are more spectral, and this is on the OHCH vibrational area. We have another match with Pinus alepensis as the anthropological analysis on the same layer of charcoals finds on Cova del Gegant confirms that we have used Pinus alepensis there. So we see it on the spectra. We have the charcoal, so it might be obvious to say that we have a good match. Indeed, if you see the European distribution map for Pinus halepensis, we are in an area of high concentration of this species. So we have, well, this is the band identification for all of them. This is the Sao Paulo dos beads. That's from this necklace. As you can see, it resembles amber. See some details as well of the resin here, Pinus resin. In the case of La Molina, we see as well more things. We found well, the resin is covered by a red pigment, and we think it's post-depositional because we have the perforation of the bead has been collapsed by calcium carbonate. It's from the it's post-depositional. And the cyanobite sprinkle over the calcium carbonate. So we think it's calcium carbonate is post-depositional, and the cyanobite as well. So we can almost discard the last individual buried of those three, and we think we can match the bead to one of those individuals based on this fact. So on XRD, what showed here, it's an oxidized polymerized abietam. This broad peak indicates that. We see here calcite and cyanobar, and the Raman spectra confirm that it's the pigment, it's cyanobar. So we think the cyanobar is spring over a white post-depositional calcite matrix. And the coating, it's made as an imitation or amber fake covering this bead. This bead is not shell, in this case it's a seed. What you see here on this bead, these black stains are manganese. So it's a transfer from some other thing that has that pattern, like square pattern. Maybe a bag, some textile, some kind of fiber that has been tanned in black, something like that. That it's as well tanning the bead. So what we have here, what we have seen here, is that we have amber imitation, fake amber. It has a similar appearance. It's made with locally available raw materials. It's a resin. It is locally available in all of the sites. Seeds and shell beads, in those cases that the beads are from a maritime environment. And in two of the three cases, these fake beads are associated to Sicilian amber beads. So these are fakes, and they have access to Sicilian amber. What are these? These are middlemen cheating them. So they are buying like more amounts, a big amounts of amber, and they give two amber beads and four pine coated beads. Well, that's the question we bring here. We don't really know. So, well, this is final remarks. Pine resin coated beads. La Molina, we think it's as well an amber fake. It's not made to be red. Locally available raw materials. These resin coatings made the bead resemble amber, so the audience will be confused and think it's amber bead. We have other imitations made with carnelian quartz, micas, other translucent beads, also imitating amber. We have found amber equivalents, and they appear associated to Sicilian amber in wealthy burials with ivory, gold, cyanobar, all things we consider they are prestige things. So maybe a low-cost production to as an easy way to increase the number of valuables. They've been cheated, they don't have other thing, they don't have access to these exchange circuits. Well, we are working on it. So any suggestion on this matter is welcome. So thank you for your patience.